Hi, I'm Paul Snyder, programming coordinator for Northwest Access TV, and you're watching Hometown Roster. It's a new show where we're going to introduce you to all the sports figures in your hometown. We're talking coaches, players, administrators, officials, and today we're going for the head coach of the BFA Girls Lacrosse team. I'm here with Mary Pipes, the head coach for BFA Girls Lacrosse. Mary, thanks for joining us today.
My pleasure. Thank you very much for asking me.
Yeah, of course. So we want to really get to know you as a coach, because a lot of people see you on the sidelines, but we really don't know anything about you. So could you give us just a little background just about yourself, whether that's, you know, where you went to college or also your coaching career?
I'm from Maryland originally, and I'm a transplanted Flatlander up here to Vermont. So I brought my love of lacrosse with me. I started playing lacrosse when I was very young, club teams. In Maryland, if you play for a club, that's a better thing to do rather than play for your school. And I'm so old that back then we didn't even have a school team. We only had a club team. So that really dates me. And I moved to Vermont in 1993. I had my children, and that's when I realized that there really wasn't, I started looking for clubs for them to start playing, because I'm very passionate about the sport. It's very big in my family. And well, down in Maryland, it's a very big sport. Anyway, it's very, very popular. It's like the hockey up here. Everyone is into lacrosse. I mean, you have a kid and somebody hands your kid a lacrosse stick at birth, you know, here you go. And really, that's about how it is. So I'm really passionate about sports. So when I found out that they didn't really have, I mean, they had started a club team here, Phantoms Lacrosse, so I involved myself in it, but my kids were younger, so they had to play on the boys team because they didn't have a girls program. So I got involved with that. And as they grew, like I said, I'm very passionate. You can ask my family. It's like 365 days a year of talking about lacrosse. I think they all get tired of it. They're like, enough already. So I started with that. That's how I got involved up here in Vermont. And I have a couple brothers. They played. They also coach. I mean, this is a big family thing. My nieces all played. But anyway, back to that. So I started participating with the Phantom Lacrosse Club as my kids were coming up. And right now, I still coach at the youth level. I coach a 7-8 team, and along with Shauna Shuttle, who coaches the 5-6. And then we have kids that are doing K-2 now, which just started this year, and very exciting. We really are trying to work on that program, getting the kids involved, getting a stick in their hand, because lacrosse is one of those sports that's very addicting. So if we feel like if we can catch them early enough, they're going to be lifelong players.
Well, I can say I never really watched lacrosse, but just being involved with you, you know, because your husband tapes the games.
He does.
As well. So, you know, for us and for you, you guys get game film and we get to air something on Channel 15. And I mean, I'm getting a little more curious about it. You know, I'm watching it for really the first time and finally seeing it. I'm like, wait, what does that mean? You know, what does that mean? So, I mean, it's definitely catching fire, I would say.
I hope so. I'll tell you, it's really funny because people think of lacrosse, they think of the guy sport with the helmets and the pads and they're all banging into each other and they're like, oh, you can't do that. I mean, it's not that we're restricted, is that really it's an entirely different sport.
Okay.
We have different rules, you know, everything is different. Just the name and the size of the ball and the size of the goal is the same. All the rest of the rules are different.
Oh, okay.
And the game is actually evolving anyway, even since I started coaching and even prior to that. Like, I played down in Maryland and I played in college, and back then.
What college?
I graduated from University of Maryland.
Oh, okay.
So, lost my train of thought. Oh my gosh, I get derailed because I'm 50 now. Am I allowed to say that? Anyway, so.
You just did so.
Whoops. Ooh, can't edit that, no. So back when I played, we didn't have restraining lines. There were no boundaries. We didn't wear goggles. The sport has really evolved. Wow. So in order to keep up with all those changes, like I think restraining lines, which maybe you understand or don't understand at this point, is the mark on the 30-yard line of either thing that's you have to have four people above the restraining line, or
okay,
you can have seven or eight below.
Gotcha.
Anyway, those are new. That started in 1998.
Oh, wow.
And then I think boundaries were introduced sometime, I want to say, in 2000. Yeah, 2000 sometime.
Okay.
And then goggles came into the program like 2004, 2006.
Because you would have thought that would be one of the earliest things to involve, for protecting the face, because all other sports by then had already, you know, started doing that. Like Little League, you had little masks and stuff like that.
Right.
Or even in hockey, I mean, back in like, you know, 56, you know, now they put masks on. So it's been years since
that. I don't think that there were really all that many injuries. I mean, when I played in college, we had a couple girls get their noses broke from sheer carelessness. But if you have good officials and they're controlling the game, it really isn't as dangerous as all that. I think the goggles actually came into play because there was a lawsuit against Rutgers College, I think. Don't quote me on that one, but I think it was against Rutgers, and that's what introduced the goggles as a safety measure. Not that I'm against it. I think it's a wonderful idea, and definitely it has helped girls not get injured. It has changed the intensity of the game, however, because whenever you get more equipment, that's just like permission to now swing your sticks a little bit more.
Sure.
So, and actually, U.S. lacrosse is attempting now to get a big grip on the sport so that those kinds of injuries aren't happening with carelessness, and they've adjusted the rules somewhat. But it definitely is an evolving sport. Oops, sorry.
Okay, great.
Pretty interesting.
Yeah. So, I mean, we talked about your husband's also involved in it as well. He does the games. Do you have your children? Are they playing lacrosse as well, as much as you talk about it? Have they caught on?
My youngest daughter plays here at BFA. She's a senior. I'm going to be sorry to see her go. Pretty interesting. She started playing, at the girls' game, she started playing in third grade, because at that time, that was the earliest that we had programmed.
Okay.
So she's kind of into it pretty much as I. My older daughter played here at BFA also.
Did she play under you?
She played under Dana.
Okay.
Actually, my youngest daughter, too, started with Dana. And then when I took over the program, she was already here. So I was stuck with her. No, just kidding. So both of them played. I coached 1 year when my oldest daughter, who's now a sophomore in college, when she was her senior year, I coached her. So it was interesting.
Okay. So how long have you been coaching for BFA?
Oh, my goodness.
As a head coach?
As a head coach, this might be my fourth year.
Okay. So now when you started,
this is my third year. I was the JV coach for 3 or 4 years prior to that.
Okay. So when you started as head coach, you guys were Division II, right?
Yes.
And you guys have only been in Division I for a couple of years.
Yep. This is our second year in Division I.
How's that transition been?
It's been a great transition for me. At the D2 level, when I first started coaching at JV, you know, there was a lot of competition in D2. But those programs have kind of fallen by the wayside, and there isn't a whole lot of intense playing down at that level anymore. I mean, there is some.
It's because the focus is gone?
Right. So a lot of the schools and programs have gone by the wayside, or their youth programs, which are so essential to develop lacrosse skills, have gone by the wayside. And so it just kind of snowballs, which is unfortunate. We're very fortunate here that we have a very strong youth lacrosse program.
Okay.
And thank you everybody that's involved in that, because without that, I would have to start out at square one every single day. And it makes it really hard to teach this particular sport. Like, say, for example, you coach softball. You don't have to teach kids how to play softball because they've been playing in middle school or elementary school, or they start out with t-ball. But lacrosse up here in Vermont, they don't start out that young unless you have a youth program that really brings it about, because it's not at the individual schools yet, which is like a big goal of mine to get the schools to start some youth programs there.
Well, it looks like there has been a following. Every time, I mean, I live only down the street, and every time I drive past here where there's a game going on, you guys got a great crowd. So a lot of people definitely come out for these games.
It's a growing sport here in Vermont. I think at one time I had 30 girls on my youth team, which is really hard when you only have 12 on the team. I had to split them into groups so that they only played certain games, so we didn't have a lot of bench time, because especially at that age, you really want to get them involved fun, and so that's kind of essential to do.
Okay. Let's talk about your website real quick. You guys have like it's Blogspot or BFA?
Comments Lacrosse. Yep.
I was on it the other day, and there's a lot going on. And I say that in a good way. Never seen a high school coach put on a website like that. Can you just tell me, that you just need to put it all out there for your players to follow, for everyone else to follow?
Well, it's pretty much out there for anyone that's interested in finding out about us. Our schedule is on there, and directions are on there, and our stats are usually on there, but I pulled them recently because I've been getting stalked by other coaches, and I don't want them to see who my best players are until they show up on the field. So I pulled that down. I'll post that again at the end of the season. But actually, I don't know if you know Mike Mashtar, the coach here at BFA, track coach and cross-country coach. He has a blog, and he uses it not in quite the same way, but he does use a blog to communicate with his players. So I kind of stole that idea from him. I'm like, these kids are all, you know, social media, whatever. And I got tired of texting them all. So I said, I'm going to create this blog spot so that they know they have to go there to find information.
There
and so we try to keep that very updated. It has made a tremendous difference with our program, and their parents aren't wondering, hey, what's going on with the games, or what's the practice schedule, or whatever. And we actually post there, and we have a Facebook page too, but that's private.
Gotcha. But you kind of take it a little step further. There's like philosophies, there's inspirational quotes.
Oh, yeah.
So
definitely.
What inspired you to add that stuff as well?
The philosophy is because I really wanted parents to understand what we're trying to do here. It's not just play lacrosse, it's not just win lacrosse games, although that's certainly part of it, because the kids are here to win, they want to play, and that's part of the fun, and that's part of what the job is. So that's part of my coaching philosophy. We are here to win, but it's more than that. It's actually about developing these kids, mentoring them, making them accountable for their own actions. Like, you can't tell me you didn't know we didn't have practice because it's on the blog. So you either checked the blog or you didn't, you know. So, I mean, that's part of helping them grow as people, and that's part of what we're trying to do here. It's not just about winning lacrosse games, although I love to win. I'm not going to say that I don't like that. Everyone loves to win.
And you guys are doing pretty good this year as well, right? For the most part, heading into the playoffs.
We are, doing okay. I'm happy with the way we're coming along. I'm thinking that maybe this year we're going to peak at just the right time. Usually we peak really early in the season. Like last year, I think we had 2 losses at the end. So we've lost 4 games, which is not really a big deal. We didn't get out on the field early enough. The weather was not,
the weather didn't cooperate.
Yeah. We couldn't get out. We were practicing in half of a gym, which lacrosse doesn't really translate well into half of a gym. But once we got out on the field, we were fine.
Okay, great.
So yeah, and the kids, they're doing great in developing skills. And we have actually some new players, which is exciting, that really have come along. I don't typically take new people, but they were athletes, and next thing you know, they're just going with it, and it's like, okay. And they're having fun. They're bringing a really interesting element to the team because they're really fresh, so everything is exciting to them.
Okay, yep.
Not that the sport isn't exciting enough, but, you know, that just adds to it.
You don't have that player that maybe has been there for years and years. You get the summer that's like, wait, we get to do this, or this is what is this all about?
Yes, so. It's a very cohesive team anyway. This is probably one of the most cohesive teams I've ever had. The girls all get along,
great,
and they hang out together, and we have team dinners and do all that kind of bonding stuff, but it's like they go the extra mile for one another.
Yeah, it definitely helps, absolutely,
it's
especially going
awesome
deep into the season. So
it is. It's pretty exciting.
Can you tell me a little bit, we're not going to put a year on it because we don't want everyone to know, but like how – in the years that you've been involved in lacrosse, can you think of like that one moment that always comes back to like, yeah, I really love that part, or I love that game, or that player, I always think about them?
Well, I'm going to say I love it when we made it to the lacrosse finals, because of course we love that part. And the thing I remember the most about that game was that during halftime, we were down by a couple goals, and rather than getting all stressed out and feeling whatever our team started to sing, because a lot of times we do videos, you know, on the way to long distance games, especially when we were D2 and we had to travel to Chelsea and to Oxbow and to wherever, we would do team videos on the bus, which is very entertaining. Girls like to sing, they're very active that way, and we'd involve whatever, everybody would be doing some part. So during halftime, I think people were like, whoa, what is wrong with them? They should be really intense. But the kids were having fun, and that's part of what we're here. We want them to have fun. It's not just the stress. You got to be able to let loose. And I can't remember how many goals we were down by, quite a few, but we got right back into the game, and probably, I mean, if we'd had a little bit more time, we would have won that. Unfortunately, Rice started to stall with like 23 minutes left in the game, and it's really hard to break the stall. So I'm hoping that U.S. lacrosse will modify the rules to prevent the long distance stalls. That's one of the things that they're actually going to work on.
Okay. So you get a little more involved in that? I don't know what that is.
I go to the U.S. lacrosse is the governing body for lacrosse. They establish our rules along with the National Federation of High Schools.
Okay.
Nationwide, they come up with the rules for lacrosse, and like I said, this is a very fluid game, so it's changing all the time. And that is one of the things that's actually going to be coming up at the lacrosse conference and prior to that. They're thinking about adding a shot clock to girls lacrosse.
Oh wow!
To eliminate that really long stall that I'm talking about.
Per player or per like possession?
Per possession. Okay. So say what they're throwing out there now. My understanding is that they're talking about once you possess the ball down your defensive end, you have a minute to get it up and attempt to score. So that's going to really increase the pace of the game.
So very similar to basketball then, right?
Yes, okay. Yes. I don't know whether it's going to pan out, but I think it's a great idea to either have a shot clock or something to eliminate, because nobody wants to come watch one team pass the ball around, the other team chase them.
Gotcha.
Even though I admit that I do that myself on occasion.
it depends on what the score is, I guess.
Because it's right.
It is part of the game.
It is part of the game right now. You know, whether it should remain part of the game, I guess they're going to make those decisions. But I'll let you know, because I'll be at the conference I go every year.
That's okay.
Another thing, I'm like, you can't keep me away. I start lacrosse. As soon as the season is over, I start planning for next season. And in January, when the U.S. Lacrosse Conference is, it's usually in Baltimore or Philly or whatever, I fly down for that. It's 3 days of just a lot of intense learning from other coaches, networking, and
that's great.
Getting involved. It's a lot of fun. I really enjoy it. I recommend everybody, you know, that's involved with lacrosse should go, because there's just so many opportunities to learn new things. And
well, it's great to see how passionate you are about a sport and bringing it to St. Albans. So
I'm very passionate about it. I am, but you know, I'm not the only one that's passionate about it. There's if you talk to like Shauna Shuttle, one of my assistant coaches, she's very passionate about the sport as well. And she and her husband helped, you know, bring the Phantom program into what it is now. So I just kind of latched onto them and you know, took over my little network.
How can people get involved in the Fenton program if they have, you know, little girls and or any boys, I guess, too, that want to get involved?
They can go right on the Phantoms website. They have a website that you can get onto and sign up for lacrosse. Usually sign-ups are in January, but you can actually sign up at any time.
Okay.
I couldn't really tell you what the fees are right now. It's a small fee because we have to pay for our field use down at Hardack.
Okay.
Usually practices are a couple times a week, and they play games, boys on Saturdays and the girls on Sundays, which sometimes interferes with people that go to church or whatever, but like myself, I'm like, I will not be at church during lacrosse season, sorry.
Yeah, but for you, lacrosse season's all year round, so. Yeah,
no, I go to church the rest of the time. No, I really do. I'm just during lacrosse season, I cannot be found there because I'm coaching or doing whatever. It's fun. People are like, wow, that's a lot. And I'm like, you know what? I really am passionate about it. So it's not, I don't mind leaving this lacrosse practice to go kids. It's fun. And we get our older girls, our varsity team is required to participate with that. So they're giving back to the community. It helps the little kids, you know, see a little what it's going to be like, and it gives them the opportunity to mentor, and we all mesh together, and it's really a good thing to see. I'm excited about how well the kids are really taking it. We've only been doing that for 3 years, but now they're like jockeying to see who can sign up to participate.
Great.
Yeah, it's kind of fun.
Yeah.
It's a really good time. I love it.
Getting back to just the memories, is there a player that sticks in your head that you can remember?
There are so many players, you know,
even a specific play, if you had one, that like just like it always replays in your head, like you remember it perfectly.
Perfectly? I can give you a general. When BFA, when we were in Division II, had never beaten Chelsea. Chelsea was a powerhouse at that time. And Chelsea is one of those teams that worked that stall we were talking about, and we never could break it. So I emailed a friend of mine, Chris Saylor, who's the Princeton coach. I shouldn't say friend, acquaintance of mine, okay? Not friend, acquaintance. She's an acquaintance of mine. I said, hey, Chris, this team always runs this stall. What can we do to break this stall? And she sent me all these ideas to incorporate into our practice plan, which Dana was coaching at the time. She and I worked together to incorporate this stall break, and it worked. And we won. And I'll tell you, it was the most beautiful feeling in the world. Because we started using the restraining line to double team them, and they just blew it. And we had a critical turnover. And the game was, we were down by one. So I can't remember what the time was left, like a minute left of the game. We had a critical turnover. And Abby Grimmer, who was a player at the time, had torn her ACL at that school the year before, but she was back and playing. So this is like poetic justice.
Oh, redemption right there.
So she got the ball, and they fouled her. And she tied the ball up, so we were still in the game with like 10 seconds left in the game with an 8-meter shot. And we had called timeout, and she's like, oh my God, Mary, I'm scared. I'm like, listen, you've got this. I know you can do it. You can do it. And we're like, we're all just hanging together saying, we believe in you, and don't worry. You know, if it doesn't work, it doesn't work. But we've never gotten this close to them before, so it doesn't matter. And we're having fun, and you're back in the game. Because she really didn't even want to play. She was so afraid, and the memory of the injury was so severe. But she did. She scored, and of course we won in overtime. It was beautiful. So that was really nice. That was really nice to be able to beat them finally. And since then, I mean, after that, they never won against us again. It's like it opened the bridge. Actually, we beat them, and Oxbow at that time was a powerhouse. We beat them. I mean, we were just on a roll after that. That's when we made it to the finals that year. It was fantastic.
Well, that's a great memory. Thank you for sharing that with us.
It was, and there's just a lot of great players. I mean, would be remiss not to mention Leilani King, our very first first team All-American.
Great.
Yeah, and there's Allie Hardy, who graduated a couple years ago. That kid could catch anything. We'd be like, she could catch anything. You could throw it at her toes, and she would catch it. The kid was amazing. It was just a lot of amazing players, you know, and a lot of really great memories. This has been, it's such a blessing to me. Like I said, people are like, oh, you're so busy, you don't know. I'm like, you know, I couldn't live without it. I just enjoy it. And people are like, when are you going to quit? Your daughter's graduating. I'm like, never. They're not kicking me out. Take my cold, dead body out of here. No. So I really enjoy it.
Good. It's great to hear.
It's a lot of fun.
Well, that's all the questions I have, and I really thank you for joining me and telling everyone who you are. And, you know, that way when they see you, you know, they just know a little bit more about you.
Thanks a lot. And if they have young girls, please sign them up for Phantoms. I promise I'll be sweet to them.
So you heard it. She lives, eats, breathes lacrosse.
I love it.
Coach Pipes.